If you're a live music fan always on the lookout for the next big sound, CapZeyez is your new monthly Thursday night plan. One Thursday a month, CapZeyez brings you live original music performances from the coolest unsigned bands, right from the awesome stage at Kick Butt Coffee. From heart-thumping rock to the weird indie stuff, Kick Butt Coffee is the home for new and established acts taking the music scene by storm. Tune in, turn up, and turn on the unheard beats of Austin's most promising talents. CapZeyez, your front row ticket to music's best-kept secrets. Music is the only truth. Seen weekly on Mondays at 7 p.m. on Austin's Public Access Channel 10.
Hey, what's going on, y'all? Welcome to CapZeyez. I'm here at the beautiful Radio East over on Montopolis with Shelly Knight. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you so much, Dave, for having me. Absolutely. I'm so happy to be here. This is a cool place. I love it.
It is. I've never been to this one. I'm a Southie, so I've been to the other one.
Yeah, me too.
We're going to be spending time with Shelly today talking about everything Shelly Knight and playing some rock and roll that she did for us at Kick Butt Coffee. We're going to go ahead and get into that, but y'all stick around and we'll find out lots of things. Woo!
They said you was crazy.
Thank you.
Hey, what's going on, you guys? You tuned in to CapZeyez, and we are spending an afternoon with Shelly Knight. You're watching the Shelly Knight Band taped at Kick Butt, laying down some tunes. We'll get her to chat a little bit about that. And I think I like to start with history. You're not new to Austin. Tell us about your history in Austin, Shelly.
I came here in 1993 to work for a radio station, which is gone. Cool 99. Good times and great oldies. I'd done radio for 3 or 4 years before that. I got into it when I was 18. Yes. I came here. I had no intention of ever doing music. I was modeling and acting and doing radio. And it wasn't until I met Eric Lycom, who I worked with at, it was the same frequency, but it was a different station. It turned into Z-Rock, and I know you remember that. It was Z-Rock, and actually became The Rock when we put Howard Stern on mornings, and I came on after Howard as the midday host. And I met Eric, and he said, I've written some songs I want you to hear. I'm like, yeah, okay. So we became friends, and he played a song, and he goes, could you sing it for me? And I said, sure, I guess. And I sang, and he goes, you got a great voice. I'm like, no, I can't sing. I mean, I'd done it in school, like choir and, you know, musicals and stuff, but I never, like, tried to go out and sing. He goes, no, you can sing. So from that, we ended up writing songs together and recording a little album, Eric and Shelly, Soul Ride, stuff, all original stuff we wrote. That turned into being the Shelly Knight Band or Shelly Knight and the Living Dead, which is what you can find us on Spotify under. Because if you change your name, what happens is you can't be listed as the same artist, and I'm not two different, well, I am two different people, but you have to list it as the same. So I just thought it was very clever. A DJ that I worked with thought that would be a good name for us. So I was like, okay, so we went with it. And two of the guys I had in the band are still with me, Fred Schultz and Andy Wood, and they were previously in a band in the early 90s called Joyfinger. They were signed to Priority Records and did some touring and opened for some, you know, bigger names, Screaming Trees, people like that. So they're alternative rock. So I basically got half of that band.
Nice.
So I got half of Joyfinger, and then me and Eric were the other half. And when those two came in, everything sort of gelled.
Let's go ahead and do this one called Something Strong.
Thank you.
might start with a riff somebody's just playing around with, and then it might go into something else. Or it might start with an idea. We want to write a song about this, and then just what we can come up with. So that's kind of like how we got together, the writing process, and just we've been doing it for a long time.
That's awesome.
A long time. I've been here, 31 years, I guess. Well, I left for a couple of years and went to New Orleans to do morning show on WRNO, which stands for We Rock New Orleans. Yeah. Eric and I actually were the morning show there, and then came back and went back into radio, and that was the period between 97 and 98. So only left Austin for a couple of years, got to enjoy New Orleans, and then came back, and when we came back, we did the record, the first record. So
God bless Sun Radio for what it's worth. We're here to talk about Shelly and I, but that's a wonderful thing in Austin.
It is good.
It's a piece of Austin.
Because you know, a lot of people say, oh, we play local music, and they might do once a day, but we're doing it three times plus a day, and then on the weekends, and then broadcasting live shows, which not a lot of people are doing that. And we do it every week. It's like, oh, we do it for South By. Well, that's great. Everybody does. But do you do it every single week?
That's,
you know,
what got me into doing this kind of thing were those live shows. You would grow up seeing concerts and hearing King Biscuit Flower Hour you know, all of that.
Mm-hmm. And I mean, that used to be the way we discovered new music and new bands. I mean, years ago, I know you and I are close to the same age, but you would hear these things, and that's how you discovered new music. It was the radio.
Yep.
MTV came along and really changed that a lot and exposed us to more of a worldwide thing. And it did change everything, but then MTV turned into a reality channel, and you can't see music videos anymore. If you want to see a music video, you have to go to YouTube or something like that. And a lot of times when I'm researching these artists that I'll play and I don't know about them, I'll go to YouTube and watch the video and go, oh, okay, and get a better idea for who they are, you know what I mean? And you see that sometimes where the two genres will cross, and you'll have an artist that now artists that cross over always do better because they're hitting two formats. That's your Taylor Swift.
Right.
We can play her on pop, we can play her on country, we can play her on adult contemporary. She's hitting a huge cross section, hence she's popular.
Yeah.
So the bands that can cross those streams, those formats, they have a bigger chance of having a bigger audience and selling more records, of course.
We came from a place where we would call DJs and ask for songs.
I would, and then you'd sit there with your cassette deck and wait for them to play it, and if they didn't play it, you'd be like, I waited all night. They were never going to play it unless you did a request show. And I had the pleasure of doing a couple of request shows here in Austin, and I absolutely loved that because that connects you with the audience. Otherwise, you're talking at them. You're not talking with them.
Yeah.
And I always loved the live interaction.
Yeah. It's crazy. And, you know, here we are in front of a camera.
Yeah.
And I used to feed off the live show, but now access doesn't go after midnight and the phone is broken. And where is that connection?
I mean, that's where you guys started, was that late night show, and people would come home from the clubs and turn it on. And you and Nathan were there, and it was like, oh, we went out and saw them. Hey, they got them on the show next week. So there was a huge tie-in between the local scene and television. And because it was indie, you could kind of do what you wanted, and you could kind of book the bands you wanted to. You weren't set to prescribed playlists like radio is.
This next one is called Resurrect Me, and it's on that Austin Rock Volume 4.
Just what you do. Come resurrect me with a love that's true.
out and play, because anyone I know anymore, as I mentioned, we're not getting paid to do music anymore.
No.
So it's about passion, songwriting, and that live vibe, right?
Yeah, and the live vibe, because, you know, you feed off that audience, and you love hearing feedback from them, like, that's my favorite song that y'all do. Could you do that one? Or they request it. Or they show up at the venue wearing your shirt. It's like, that shows you there's some love there, and I mean, that's priceless. And sure, you can't draw huge crowds, because in Austin, there's so much of it that people take it for granted. Like, every night there's shows. But if you go to a smaller market and you do a show, everyone shows up.
Yep.
And I've had much better luck going and playing outlying areas like Taylor and Lockhart and places like that, because the people there are like, oh, there's live music, and they come and support it. Here, it's like, it's every day, we don't care. And musicians built this town. It was built on their backs, and yet they're the ones that are treated the worst, and most of them have moved out, because you show me somebody that does music full time in Austin and nothing else and can afford to buy a house here.
Mm-hmm.
You can't.
They're not.
You can't. You just can't. Because it's just not feasible.
You speak Taylor, have you played Black Sparrow then?
Oh yeah, love Shannon. Oh my God, that is like one of the best venues. And the sound in there, she's fantastic.
Part of my heart is like in awe of her passion for analog.
Yes.
She's all analog, screw this digital.
Mm-hmm. I started with analog. I mean, when my first radio show, it was reel to reels, albums and carts. Carts are like 8 tracks.
Yeah.
And we had one CD player and about 15 CDs. So I had to learn how to load tape. And then when I went into production, which I did for a long time in radio, I had to splice with splicing tape and razor blades. And the first station I worked for was so cheap, they wouldn't buy splicing tape, we used Scotch tape. But if you rewound the reels too fast, it would pop. It would break. But I had to learn how to do everything analog.
Yes.
And I just have a deep place in my heart for that, because it is different.
It is.
It is warmer. It's more real.
Yep.
Doing all these pitch corrections and, you know, whatever you can do on digital.
AI,
that didn't exist when we were growing up. It was, this is the band and this is the sound. And, you know, the live album would be a live album. You know?
All right, this one's called Freedom.
We'll be right back.
So the songs you're playing at Kickbuck for us, I understand, are either mostly or all new tracks you're working on for the new record?
Yes, the new record will be four. I decided to just go 2, 3, 4. I mean, that way I know which order I release them in. But I like the idea what Chicago did. Chicago 1, Chicago 2, Chicago 3. You don't have to come up with a title. You know the sweet sequence of the albums. And I just was like, okay, this next one's 4. So the next one's 4. Instead of, what was, which album was that? That was, which was that, the second or third? Everyone knows it's 4.
That's great.
So yeah, everything we played at Kickbutt was new with the exception of one song, or two actually. One was on the first record, and then one was on 3, and it was on the Austin Rock compilation that came out that had Nathan on it and stuff.
Yes.
Nathan.
It's weird doing these things now without Nathan. I miss seeing him out there making faces at me while I do this kind of stuff and fart noises.
He was the funniest person I think I've ever met in my life.
It's amazing.
Just every time I would see him, he would say something so funny. And the one song we did, Freedom, that night, I was like, I don't want no bun to tell me no. I remember he came to our CD release party and we had played that song, which will be on the next one. We were played it at that CD release party. And he came up to me after and he goes, I love that song. I don't want no one to tell me no. He goes, that's awesome. That is my favorite. And so every time I play it now, I think about him. So I had to do it in the show because he told me he liked that one. Because it's so like sassy and I don't want anybody to stand in my way. And I said, yes, this is a Nathan song. So I always think of him when I play that. I have a big spot in my heart for Nathan. And he left a huge hole in this community. When he decided to leave Austin.
Yeah. Yeah.
Or when, you know, his body said it was time to go.
Yeah.
All the cool people are leaving.
Yeah.
But that was a huge shock, and I don't know if we'll ever recover from that. But his legend is alive and well. And the fact that we've still got all this stupid drama stuff and the dancer stuff and his pictures at the airport, thank goodness it's going to stay.
Yeah.
Just a huge loss. Yeah. What an amazing person. All the way around. So supportive of everyone. Just always had something good to say. I mean, he was on Bobby Sharon's show and he mentioned us one night and he goes, you know, Shelly Knight band, that's a really good rock and roll band if you like rock and roll. And I was like, yeah, Nathan likes me, he likes me. But that meant the world to me because he'd been around for so long and he'd been in the business for so long and worked with so many people, and that made me feel so good to know that I had his respect. So
everybody seemed to know something about Nathan and have a Nathan story. He was probably one of the first people to, you know, that you hear the phrase now, talk about people when they're not in the room, you know.
Yes.
And he always was.
Yes, so. He just was so supportive of everyone, and he would sit there and stay until the last band finished. And just
wrap cables.
He would wrap cables. I mean, just had no, like, big ego. He could have. Because he was so massively talented. He could have been like, don't talk. He could have been one of those guys. But he was just like all hugs. Come over here and hang with me. What's going on with you guys? I got to come to your next show. I mean, just always like so supportive and cool. And I just, yeah, love the dude. All right, this next one I'm going to dedicate to a whole lot of people. There have been a whole lot of people that are leaving Austin and going to a better place. And they are... Their spirit is here, but their remains are in some sort of a box. And I originally wrote this for my father, but I want to dedicate it to all my friends that I've lost in the past year. Nathan being one of them, Fred's father, our friend Jorge, our friend Jim. Anybody else I'm forgetting? We've lost a lot of friends. And we want to go ahead and do this song for all of them. It's called The Box. to me, it's not about the money. It's about getting out and being on stage. And early on, we decided to record every single live gig digitally. I haven't done that so much lately, but every single one, and then listen back to it and critique ourselves. Because you don't know how they hear it. You know how you hear it from the monitor mix, yep. But you want to hear how the people are hearing it.
Totally.
And from there, you can kind of clean it up and say, ooh, that part didn't work, or we need to do this differently. We need to fix the ending of that. And I think that was the only way we were able to progress as a band, by sitting there and really listening to every single show we ever did. I've always liked to ask people, what are you currently listening to? I'll always ask that of an artist. So I'm going to ask you, what are you currently listening to?
Oh, gosh. You know, to be honest, my wife is tracking for a new record,
mm-hmm.
So I have been listening to like the rough cuts
of
all of these new songs. So I've been listening to Jimmy George stuff a lot.
Oh yeah, he's
an
great.
Amazing
fantastic.
Artist.
And all the stuff he does with looping and that. Love you, Jimmy. You're fantastic.
Yeah, it's great.
He's great.
Do you have something you would consider home turf? What, like when you go out and find a Shelly Knight Band gig? Or gig finds you?
Mm-hmm.
Are you just kind of taking what's available, or do you
have
a plan?
I take what's available, but I mean, mostly we play Anderson Mill,
yep.
Kick Butt, Come and Take It, because
yep.
Those are the venues that embrace the harder rock. I mean, you can get out there and scream and have wailing guitars, and I found that I've got stuff that leans a little more country and Americana that I do acoustic, and then I've got the harder rock stuff, which I prefer
yep.
to do, but I can do either. So if you wanted me to play like a coffee shop set, I could, but I prefer to be loud and have the amps and you know, really rock out. But I found that I was not hard enough for the that kind of stuff. I wasn't hard enough for them, but I was too hard for the country kind of stuff.
Totally.
So I'm kind of in that space
yeah.
where it could go either way.
Yep.
And there's some stuff that I do that's almost outlaw kind of things. Like I got a song called Whiskey.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, things like that where it's like, does it really fit in that genre or this genre? Well, it doesn't really fit in any genre. It's just kind of music.
Yeah.
Shake up the dust.
does one find music from Shelly and I then?
Spotify's the quickest way, but we're on everything, Apple Music, iTunes. You can find us on, Reverb Nation. Mm-hmm. I have everything on Reverb Nation, which is kind of where our press kit is. Facebook links, you can check out videos there. So just all the socials, Instagram.
Awesome.
But mostly you can listen to it on Spotify. I'm really not putting CDs in stores because people are not really shopping for CDs anymore. Now when the vinyl is released, yeah.
That's awesome.
But you can also buy it online, cdbaby.com. Just look up Shelly Knight and the Living Dead and you can find it there. And we'd love your support.
And before we go, anything people would never know about Shelly Knight? Special talents, secrets? Can you juggle?
No, but I do like to draw, and I have done some hand-drawn posters for shows. In fact, when I first started, I did a lot of hand-drawn ones. So I like to draw and do art and stuff like that, other than sing and be on the radio and be on stage, and yeah.
What advice would you give someone who's in the garage at home going, I'm just playing for fun. What do you think? Like, what's the next step? What advice would you give a musician who doesn't consider themselves a musician?
Well, I mean, fake it till you make it. Have faith in yourself. Years ago, Shelly King told me something, and she's a friend that we often get confused. Shelly Knight, Shelly King, but Shelly King's a friend. And I sang for her, and the first time I think I sang and she was there, it was an open mic, and I was terrified, and my eyes were closed, and I didn't even move. I think I sat on a stool and just like this the whole time. And she came to me after and she said, "You got everything you need but confidence. You got everything you need but confidence." So I found that. You saw that in the video. I found the confidence. And once you find that and believe in what you're doing, I think that's the main thing. It doesn't matter if anybody likes it. You're doing it for you. It's like, I can do some cover songs in my set, and I enjoy those, but I'm not doing it to play someone else's songs. I'm doing it to play my songs and tell my story. I always made it kind of a personal policy not to drink before I perform. After, yeah, I might have a beverage, but it's like a job. You wouldn't show up and do your job drunk, would you?
Mm-hmm.
No. So treat it like a job, because your fans deserve the best. They deserve the best of you. They came to see you. They didn't come see you get drunk. They came to see you perform, and you need to give them the best performance you possibly can. If they've walked through that door, paid that cover, that's what you're doing. You're doing it for them. You're doing it for you, but you're doing it for them. And being trash is not professional to me. I mean, you can drink if you want to before shows, but I guarantee you'll play better when you're focused. You really
Great
will.
Advice. Nathan would always say, "Drink up, we sound better."
Love him.
Love Nathan.
Love Nathan.
Shelly, thank you for doing this with me. Thanks for playing Kickback Capsize
Sessions.
Thank
you so much, Gabe. Hugs.
Hugs. Sweaty hugs.
We've been in town a long time, so yeah, we can do that. We've known each other a long time. Best of luck to you with all of the great stuff you're still doing with CapZeyez, carrying on that tradition that you and Nathan started years ago. I got nothing but respect and nothing but love.
Nothing but
love.
Nothing
but love.
Woohoo!